is global. We went through a massive series of changes, moving away from a hierarchical feudal system of government in the West, in Europe principally. And that involved changes on a lot of different levels. There were a lot of different facets to that. So some of them were political, some were epistemological, changes in science, in how we think about the world. There were political changes, medical changes, economic changes, the move to capitalism. So it was a complete revolution in how society is structured, and how we think about the world. And I think that we're experiencing a revolution that in many respects is similar to that, has the same kind of scope and magnitude as that. A postmodern revolution in how we think, how we communicate, and in how structures exist. I think we're a little behind. I mean, there's going to be some catching up in terms of political stuff, because those frameworks are a little more monolithic. There's a lot more structure there. But in terms of how people think, how people perceive themselves, their sense of identity, we're moving away from the individualism of the Enlightenment more towards, I think, a communitarian model. And people are more and more starting to think of themselves as global citizens as well. And I think a large part of that are these revolutions within communications, how we connect with people. So, you know, sure, we still have relationships with the people around us. We still are connected intimately with family members. So that clan system, if you like, is still a part of who we are for the most part. And we exist within communities. We have work communities and such. But a lot of the communication that we do, a lot of the connection that we're experiencing now is broader than that. And I think it's tremendously exciting. So in that sense, I think there's massive potential for change, and at an astoundingly fundamental level. So it's not just a shift in who has the power, it's a shift in our very conception of power and the nature of power itself. So I see that taking place, and it seems to be occurring fairly rapidly. So even within the space of my lifetime, even within the last few decades, there have been massive transformations.
So what are some specific examples of where you're seeing this this new type of revolution? It's communitarian type of revolution.
So, I mean, I think just in terms of how we communicate and interact and how we think of ourselves, how our sense of personal identity, like it seems far broader now. When I talk to young people in particular, I work with young people a great deal. It's very much about, you know, their place in the world, and they perceive themselves as having a place in the world. So it's not just about the little community or the specific, you know, job goals and ambitions and such. They're thinking about the impact that they're going to have upon the world and what they want the world to look like. That wasn't the case when I was growing up. I mean, there were a few people who were outwardly focused like that, but I wasn't, and most of the people that I interacted with weren't. And so it seems like there's been a pretty radical shift in that respect. If you're asking me how it's changed in terms of like politically, the impact that it's had politically, you know, I think that it's impacted those structures a little less than it's impacted thought processes, but even in that respect, you know, I see there's some big changes that have occurred. And Bernie Sanders, his candidacy for the presidency would be a prime example of that. You know, the idea of somebody who is explicitly a socialist running for the highest office in the USA is that's a pretty miraculous thing that he gained. The support that he did. I know he wasn't successful, but
he was incredibly successful. He just didn't win.
Right. Yeah. Successful in the sense of winning. Yes.
Yeah.
There are many other ways to measure success, and I mean that's what I'm saying, that perceived in respect of those things, it was astounding. For somebody who grew up in the 80s, it's nothing short of miraculous.
Yeah. Yes, it's strange times. I mean, I think Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders are signs of something strange in the air, this thirst for change from the populace and the disenfranchised populace who are growing to just recognize they are not in control of the two major political parties in the country, that these are these two political parties that control politics are controlled by power brokers in those parties and the networks of people that support those power brokers. Mm-hmm. And so we're in for interesting times in the next, it'll be very interesting. I wonder if it'll like continue if, you know, the next round of presidential elections, will we have like, will it happen again, or will we slide back into have just these mainstream establishment candidates?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the things that strikes me is that, you know, when I was growing up back in the 80s, going through high school and into college, relativism was a fairly fringe notion. So the idea that the ideas that we have, the views of right and wrong that we have, and true and false even. So thinking of it in epistemological terms as well as kind of moral political terms, the notion that those ideas might not be absolutely true, or that there might not even be an absolute truth attainable within those fields, was a pretty radical notion. And it did not have a tremendous amount of mainstream support. But talking to people now, there's tremendous support for that, to the point where it is almost the accepted reality. You know, when I talk to young people now, it's almost a given that you leaving.
Like, oh, you put me to sleep.
But they, you know, they will say, you know, well, of course, you know, that's just my opinion, and I know that you know, that's my truth, that's my reality. You know, I hear people saying that sort of thing a great deal, and the fact that has become such an established way of thinking of reality is that's pretty remarkable. Like that is a revolution right there. That notion has become so mainstream. It's been a part of philosophy for a long time through the existentialist movement and the postmodern movement, but that people generally are saying that and accepting that is, it's fresh and it's remarkable.
What notion? I'm serious. Like,
that their ideas are relative, that they are not absolutely true. That there's an element of subjectivity.
Yeah. Yeah, but it doesn't help when you're trying to facilitate this recognition of relativity, relative truth. Certainly muddies the water sometimes, you know, and makes people it's sort of like, well, yeah, anything that muddies the water with trying to establish some sort of common truth it just makes things more challenging. And it sort of like, it forces you to try to challenge people to be a little bit more enlightened about what is true and what they want and what they need.
It's enormously challenging. And I think in many ways, it's terrifying. And I think that is what we're seeing in Trump. He's tapping into that. So Trump is not a contradiction of that. Trump is a symptom of that. I think there are a lot of people who really don't like it and really crave a simpler kind of black and white perspective. They want that to be the reality, and less is it the narrative of life, of modern life.
Yeah.
So, you're getting back to your platform, your kind of communications platform. And, you know, I see that as a part of that. It's exciting because it's kind of tapping into that. It's allowing people to communicate in a fairly fresh way, en masse.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. It'll be an interesting experiment if and when actually take an attempt at doing something with any sort of significant audience. I mean, we did do an event with, we had like 15 to 20 people in there, but the platform didn't do everything it does now. And it was really just sort of a technical test.
Yeah.
So I have not yet attempted to facilitate any number of people with it.
Yeah. So I know we were talking that we've talked a few times actually about the, a metaphor, if you like, a way to symbolize what it is. And to me, I've been thinking about it a little bit. And to me, it seems very much like a mind. So the way that it functions, you're talking about it in terms of having nodes. So that image of a mind, of having these kind of areas that are getting excited, that are becoming warm, and the connections between them, and the fact that it has an organic flavor to it, that it's not, you can't just be reduced to a collection of mechanical impulses, and that, you know, the ideas within the mind are created through that interaction, through that participation of the various nodes.
I think you're right. I think the mind is definitely probably the best metaphor. I mean, I was going with the hive. And another one that, you know, I've played around with is collective. But there is not really a great, I mean, it's like you only have what metaphors do you use for a group of people of any size that in which everyone is equal, totally equal in power. And, and they work together in a very positive, harmonious way. I mean, there's team. I mean, you said community was one idea you threw out there. A mind. I mean, a mind is not how you refer to a group of individuals.
Right.
But I think in terms of, I think you're right in terms, I've called it the hive mind.
Sure. Yeah, I think one of the problems, and we talked a little bit about this, is that, you know, most of the metaphors that are out there, the associations, the images, the iconography that's out there with respect to this is embedded, it's rooted in a culture of individualism. And what you're trying to do, what you're trying to achieve and put together is contrary to that. It's a contradiction of that. So all of the positive metaphors have been kind of co-opted by that culture, the culture of individualism, and all of the metaphors for, you know, collective process have been sullied, they've been tarnished So all of the images that we have, all of the images that have been presented to us through your science fiction books and movies, and even political discourse to some extent, those communitarian ventures have been presented in a dystopic manner. So generally, when you think of, you know, a whole group of individuals acting harmoniously towards a common good, there's almost an element of horror movie to that. Just because it's been presented in such a negative way for so long. So it's tough to find really positive associations. It's tough to find positive iconography for something like that. You almost have to create it fresh, because it's something fresh that in some sense is dramatically countercultural.
So do you think, I haven't done much really significant promotion or networking with this. And currently I am a little bit entrenched in the hive, using the word hive for what, yep, what I'm doing. That's the domain we have, hive1.net, in addition to the globalconsensusproject.org, which is that's a big word. Do you feel like we need to pivot to a different metaphor, or can we go with hive one until, I could go with hive one until I build up some level of community interest and let them help pick a different one, you know, just let the hive pick a new name, a new word. sure. Because I know you said the hive metaphor is, you felt it was a big turnoff, and I've had other people sort of be like turned off by it. But I need to replace it with something. If I'm going to let go of it, I have to have something, and I have to be able to get a domain that works for whatever. So if we went with mind, mind wouldn't be available. Mm-hmm.
The global neural net.
That's a pretty big word.
global neural. It is.
I'm not opposed. That's not bad. I didn't want to call it human, human something, because I feel like that's a little speciest,
My daughter would be very upset with you. Discriminating against dogs and such.
Well, I just think there could be other conscious beings, computers could become conscious, or there could be other. Mm-hmm. I was trying to stay away from human-centric language.
Right.
But what do you think? Do you think it's urgent we leave the hive metaphor?
Well, I think hive has some positive associations. I think it maybe requires a little bit of rebranding. So not necessarily rejecting hive, but just being conscious moving forward of some of the associations that people have with it. But I don't think there is a good alternative. That's the problem, is you're having to create it. So maybe you're the person that creates the association, or not you, but what it is you're doing, what it is you're a part of.
And if we, if a hive, we'll go with the hive word. So say there is a hive, a human hive that is created, that is not an oppressive hive. It's a collective of conscious beings in which you are able to, when you participate in it, you're fully able to express yourself in whatever manner you see fit. Yet you are able to tap into this mass collective of conscious beings and work together in really interesting, creative ways. And I have a number. I guess my question was going to be: Does that pique your interest as to something that you would be interested in participating in or connecting to? I'm not sure you can, it's easy to answer that without more specific sort of examples of what types of experiences you could have participating in this. Because I think there's a huge spectrum of things you could be doing, like collaborative storytelling is one. Like, I think there's a lot of fun, just sort of like just blatantly fun things you could be doing. Like we learned from social media, you know, there's lots of fun things you could do with social media. We could play games, we could write stories. And we could do that in this Hive platform. I mean, ultimately, my hope is that we learn how to use it to control our collective power in interesting ways. But I'm also sort of like brainstorming just like things that would draw people in to just experience it and test it and learn about it.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Well, I think, you know, there's a sense in which I don't really need the specifics. When you think of communication, that, you know, there are a lot of pragmatic motives for engaging in communication. That there's a lot of things that we try to accomplish in a tangible sense through communication, and emotion as well. But one of the most basic things that we do through communication is connect with people. It's a form of relationship, and any communication, kind of face-to-face, in-person communication, is a form of relationship. And it, you know, might be abusive, but assuming that it's not abusive, that it's not oppressive in some way, then it is the most kind of raw, fundamental way in which we can connect with people, along with kind of physical touch. And it's far more commonplace than that. There aren't that many people that we physically interact with, but it's, you know, there are a lot of people that we communicate. So when we communicate with people, it's an expansion of who we are. We're making a part of who we are visible to somebody else, and they're making a part of themselves visible to us. So there's an exchange of personhood that is taking place there, and an expansion of both the people that are involved in that process. So it's an incredibly powerful and impactful and potentially very beautiful thing, communication. And the notion that could be expanded and that we could do that en masse with a massive quantity of people is tremendously exciting. And it, I mean, it's sort of fresh territory in a way, because, you know, for so long communication has been about, you know, person to person, looking at the body language, assessing all those subtle cues, the inflection, and it's been the model, the kind of iconic model, is one-on-one communication, and this is it's trying to capture some aspects of that, kind of the essence of that, but with an entirely new model. So it's challenging and it's exciting. And if it can do that, if it is successful in doing that, then that's wonderful. So how people use it in a sense is, I mean, sure, it's relevant and will to some extent inform how excited I get about participating in it. But there's a sense in which, just structurally, it's attractive just in terms of what it may offer.
Awesome. It's so refreshing to hear positive feedback mm-hmm. about the concept. It's amazing how much negative feedback you can get when you share ideas, especially like really outside the box ideas mm-hmm. with people. And there's something about the internet. There's something about sharing ideas on the internet that I think has changed the nature of what it's like to be a human. You know, it's like, you know, it's like, back in the day, you would like, you know, you had a crazy idea, you'd be sharing it face to face with people. And you would get face to face feedback, which would be, But when you're face to face with someone, there's things that prevent you from really, really being a jerk and really ripping apart a person's idea. But even then, but the internet takes it to a whole new level. Not only it takes away some of that face to face, but there's an anonymity on the internet, and so it's like, it's just like the dark side of humanity. When you share, like, you put a video on YouTube or you share something, it's like any joke that could be made, no matter how inappropriate, there'll be someone out there who will make the joke, even if it's really rude or off color, if they are under the shield of anonymity. So it's like, anyways, a bit of a tangent to what you're saying. That basically just thank you for,
I don't think it's really a tangent. I think it's rooted in a lot of the same issues that, it's such a sudden thing, this revolution in communication and how we communicate. Working with young people, again, you know, a great deal of who they are, their personal identity and their relationships is electronically mediated. And there's a lot of criticism of that, I mean, particularly from older people in my generation. People are very dismissive of it. They go, oh, you know, they don't have the communication skills. They're not gaining those communication skills. It's so shallow. It's no substitute for actual kind of physical communication. And I don't think that's the case. I think that there is a richness to it and a potential to it that is not generally appreciated by these people who critique it. But it's hard. There are all sorts of challenges connected to it, that anonymity being one. How we apply it, you know, how do we not be mean to each other when we're interacting from behind that veil? How do we send the subtle cues? How do we substitute for those physical cues that we're usually getting when we're interacting physically? You know, how do we do that without the physicality? And we're working that out. You know, it's a process. So there's definitely some painful aspects to it, and people are just vicious online in ways that they wouldn't be.
Yeah.
Personally.
Yeah.
But I think that's the nature of it, and it's evolving. And we'll figure that out. But then technology will evolve, and we'll be faced with fresh challenges. But the idea that it should just be forgotten, be eliminated, and we should not explore it because there are these challenges just seems like the most rank form of cowardice and narrow-sightedness imaginable.
Yeah, it's unusual for an old person like yourself to be so open-minded about the digital generation and people glued to their smartphones. That's not the normal thing that's expressed by a person as yourself.
Yeah. I think there's an amazing untapped potential there. I think that every grandparent should get a Snapchat account. And that it would be a phenomenal way for grandparents to keep in touch with their grandchildren.
Oh yeah. And
very, very effective. So there's, you know, there's amazing power there if we would embrace it, and potential for intimacy and connection, if only we would embrace it.
Yeah. This is one situation. So you like sparked like two different threads that I could have pursued, but I'm letting them both go.
Kind of a two parts in the forest kind of a situation.
Yeah, and I literally I'm
I
letting
took neither.
It took neither. I mean, they're both like interesting ish, but you know, I'm trying to be
generous.
You know, I'm just not, you know, it's part of my attempt to be a more mindful communicator is just because I have a thought that I could say that has, that is interesting. I'm not necessarily going to say it. I'm trying to be selective and careful. I guess, I mean, so let me share with you like one thing I sort of envision that could happen. It's a bit of a tangent again. Or not. Where do I go into that? I guess this is why when you start, you really, this is why people have plans when they go into shows. They have a plan of what you want to talk about. So you feel like you've accomplished.
So they have questions, the person that they're interviewing.
Yep. Well, you and I just, we've just been good at winging it, but those were two situations where you were the interviewer, so you kind of owned the stage, so the weight of responsibility was on your shoulders. Here, it's like there's a shift of weight onto me, in addition to the ridiculous amount of technical stuff that I've put on top of doing for this show. Wow. So, okay. So would you be interested in sort of co-hosting an attempted facilitation of an audience? Some sort of that thing was made to be interactive with the audience, trying to get people to use the Hive software platform to communicate with us. Would you be interested in doing something like that?
Sure. Yeah. I think that would be exciting.
Yeah. Well, I have a number of ideas that could be really interesting and fun. And part of it is, you know, attracting, you have to attract people to the mm-hmm. event. You know, it's like, so we could like, I could run a few of those ideas by you. In fact, we could use the Hive software where I could list the different ideas, and I don't know if I showed you this part, but they are threaded. So you actually, once you have an idea listed, you can click on it and go into that idea and then explore that further. Kind of like a mind map. You ever seen a mind map that's threaded like that? So that's kind of, that's how the nodes in the platform work. So it's each idea can go to more ideas, and so we could attempt to use that, or we could just talk and brainstorm ideas.
Sure.
And then at some point I have to bite the bullet and actually like say we're going to have a show or an event, and I have to like invite like or promote it to actually try to get like a number of people in there using it. I have this hesitance to like use my friend network. You know, it's like I'd rather have like 100 of people that I don't know from around the world or something in there and sort of get it cranking before friends drop in, because does that make any sense?
Yeah, it makes sense.
All right, well, we've been going, we're at an hour and 18, and so I'll probably like edit this down to 15 minutes of quality content now.
The nuggets.
But this is great. I really, I mean, I don't know if this was great because so much was relying on me. But this is our third actual recorded episode interview that we've done together, you know, over the last several years. I haven't actually watched the first one ever. I don't think I have a recording of that, and it's not still online.
I can find it for you.
Yeah. I think if you could put that online or just send it to me or something, sure. I'll put it online. That would be fun. And so thank you so much. We'll wrap it up here if that's all right with you. Christopher Mason, you are very, very generous in putting up with the technical difficulties of this, and you are always an interesting person to talk to. I feel like we can go to pretty much in so many different directions. It is a bit overwhelming, the different topics we could go into. But thank you so much, and your feedback has been very helpful on this project. Definitely going to enlist your help for future episodes and events. Is there anything you want to say to the world? Do you have any like website or Twitter accounts or anything that you like to share out there for the vast audience to hear about? Anything like that?
No, nothing exactly like that. No blog or presence in that respect. I mean, I have the shows, the interviews, but they mostly have a local flavor. So I'm not sure they would be that compelling for a general audience outside of Middlebury. I have an Austin Mason Facebook page and a Twitter account.
All right. So if people find you fascinating, Officer Mason on Twitter and Facebook, yes. And Middlebury 5-0 is the show, the cable access show.
That's right.
All right.
It's been a pleasure. Thanks so much for having me on as your inaugural guest.
Yes. Well, inaugural live shared guest. Yes. I've done a few interviews, but haven't shared. Sure.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. And everyone out there, thank you for watching. And feel free to visit theglobalconsensusproject.org or hive1.net to learn more about what the project behind this podcast. So we'll call that's a cut officially from the show. And nobody is watching anything that we're doing. So we can just talk. It is so weird trying to talk when you're aware of the potential pressure of other eyes listening to us.
Yeah.
How much does that affect you?
It's an acquired skill. it's a little bit like, when you're reading out loud. I don't know if you've done a lot of reading out loud, but I read to Jennifer and Claire quite a bit. But you don't read the part that you're focusing on. You focus on the words that are, you know, a sentence or two ahead. So you're reading, the words that are coming out of your mouth are what you remember reading a little while before. And that's how you avoid screwing it up. If you're doing that, you know, you're looking at the grammar that's coming up ahead, so you modulate your speech. You know that it's building towards a question, so your intonation is correct. So you're always, your mind is focused ahead of what's coming out of your mouth. And interviewing somebody is a little bit like that. Like as you're listening to the person speaking and you're processing what they're speaking, your mind is not really focusing on that. It's moving towards framing questions and moving the conversation in different directions. And so it's an art of, you've got to have one part focused very much on the moment and what's happening, but there's another part of you that is actively kind of planning and thinking about kind of what's coming up next. And it can be very challenging to do that. And it's a simultaneous kind of a thing.
It's interesting. It's a totally different mental skill than facilitating a group.
Oh yeah.
And so it's in a way, it's a quite a challenge to set myself up to think of trying to combine the two of being like interacting and facilitating a mass audience while also interviewing someone or having a conversation with someone. That might not be the best thing to try to do. It might be, it might be better to make the event a facilitating the audience event. And so, and even if you're here with me, you're co-facilitating. So we are not thinking about what we're saying to each other. We're both focused on the audience, and we're not talking to each other. We're talking to the audience, and we're seeing what they say and seeing their reactions, and asking questions, and we're asking questions of them. And maybe we're taking, using this software or using just YouTube, we could actually let them share video and talk to us.
Right. Having a conversation, typically, like if you sit down and you actually have a conversation with someone face to face, that's typically something that engages almost the entirety of yourself.
Well, if you're present,
you are pouring yourself into that interaction. So, there are distractions, there's things going on, and your mind may wander and you start thinking about the dishes you have to wash or some obligation at work or something like that. But a huge amount of who you are is focused upon interacting with that person. It's very consuming. So having a conversation with someone that has the appearance of that, like you're fully engaged, but structurally there's a whole part of you that is not, that is focused upon something else entirely that's going on, simultaneously or is going to be happening in the future, it's very difficult. It's not what conversation usually is. It's something entirely different. So I think you're right that if just having an interviewing someone just in itself, like in the studio, that is challenging. That is really difficult to do effectively so that it looks like a good conversation. It has the feel of a conversation. Right? But your situation where you're trying to do that, you're trying to interview someone and use all those skills where you're thinking ahead to what questions you're going to be asked and monitoring the way the conversation is evolving. But you're doing all of that, you're trying to do all of that I did in the studio, but on top of that, you're also in control. You're doing all the production as well. So that's like adding everything that Jennifer was doing into the mix and putting that on your shoulders. And the technical stuff that you're doing actually involves kind of feedback potentially from other people that are out there. So it's, in a sense, it's way more complex than what Jennifer's doing. That may be a little too much for one mind to be able to process all at once. And what's probably going to happen is that you're just not going to be able to very effectively interview people because you have all this other stuff that is intruding and not allowing you to focus on the conversation or focus on where you want to take the conversation.
I think if I had nothing to do with any sort of technical thing or audience, and I was just interviewing, that would be a challenging task for me to do that well.
Right. But if I had to do Jennifer's job at the same time as doing what I do in the studio, not that I'm, like a star interviewer or anything like that, but I it would be completely chaotic. No, there really wouldn't be a show. It would be so choppy. It wouldn't do justice to my guests. So it just wouldn't work.
Yeah.
So I wonder if you need to rethink the interview format or rethink production. Like either you need to find some way to take you out of the production or some way to not be interviewing somebody while that process is going on. Either way, I think would work, but it's too much probably.
Well, I mean, that is one of the ideas. That's one of the ideas that I've definitely played with is take me out of the interviewer role and have someone else be the host. And it could be rotating guest hosts, or it could be a panel. I mean, it'd be very easy to use software like this to make a panel of four or five people even, and just have, I mean, also if I make it four or five people and I'm not like the facilitator, I could potentially be the technical, I'd be doing all the technical stuff, but I'm not in charge of the conversation. You know, the right. silence that happens is not now demand me to do something about it, you know?
Sure.
But even just taking me off camera and just, and I would be really focused on the audience and seeing, but I mean, a podcast has, it does have a different, a podcast, a show has a different purpose than some of the stuff I want to do with the Hive software. I mean, the interacting, facilitating the audience, that's a different type of event. And so it could be, I just need to like actually try to do some of the types of events that I designed the software for.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not talking about the Hive thing, but even just interacting with YouTube and having the potential there for people to give feedback as the show is being broadcast, or potentially join the conversation. It's hard to imagine you being able to process that and coordinate that in a way that was really smooth and seamless. Like, it's always going to be a little bit choppy.
Yeah.
I know I wouldn't be able to do it. I would not be able to juggle all those things simultaneously. Maybe there are people out there who have those skills, but that's not me. And maybe you would acquire those skills if you did it a lot. Maybe you get better and better at it, and eventually it would be really smooth and seamless.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, this was a pretty crazy experiment. I mean, even just the fact that I made this an open room and shared it, and we had that random guy drop in, you know, it's like we're talking in a public space and anyone could pop in. And I think actually twice people popped in on us.
Yeah. Yeah.
But then that was kind of weird. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that was really helpful for, it was funny.
Yeah. Yeah. They left pretty quick. I wonder if it was even intentional, if it's, they kind of knew what they were doing, or.
I think maybe, I would expect the guy that dropped in wasn't hoping to be like the third person. If he was like the 15th person, then he would have like slipped in and, you know, but yeah. When he saw, wait, I'm a third wheel here. He's like,
yeah.
And we weren't.
Yeah. Probably just wanted to take just an anonymous kind of little glimpse.
Yeah. And that's kind of some of the beauty of what you can do with this Zoom software. It's like creating these audio video rooms, and people could be dropping in and out and going from conversation to conversation.
Right.
It's pretty powerful stuff.
Yep.
Could be really interesting.
So I gotta get ready for work.
All right. Thank you so much.
Gonna get some lunch and clean up.
Great talking to you, even though most of it was under the stranglehold of the interview situation.
That's fun. Anytime.
All right.
Yeah, if there's a time where you have like a bunch of specific topics, I can weigh in on that too. You know, it can be a little more, a little less broad as well. I'm open to that.
Oh yeah, I think I'll do more planning and have a direction for it to go. Especially if I'm gonna still be the technical everything, that right. would help. My next question is this. Now talk while I do all this stuff.
All right.
All right. Love. Thanks, you, Chris. Love you too. Talk to you later.
Bye.
Bye.